Thank you everyone for joining this Ignite webcast. My name is Josh Topal and I'm a Program Manager for Office 365. And Ignite events are a series of technical workshops for IT professionals and Microsoft partners. So these Ignite webcasts will address different technical subjects and scenarios that are really beneficial to anyone who wants to increase their knowledge of the Office 365 suite. So today we're really excited to have Lucas Costa leading us on our webcast. And Lucas is a senior service engineer at Microsoft. And in today's webcast, he'll be diving into Office 365 Password Sync. So today's session provides a really great opportunity to hear directly from a Microsoft employee and really learn more about some of the new features and releases for Office 365. So today's webcast will be about an hour, and we're going to leave a few minutes at the end to field any questions from anyone on the call. So you can go ahead and type your questions into the link chat box during the presentation, but I do ask that you hold those questions till the end for our Q&A session. So we are recording today's session, and we'll have the slideshow and the video recording on the original blog post, which you could find right there at the link I pasted in. And one last thing, we are recording today's session, so please understand that you may be captured in today's video. So if you do not wish to be recorded, please do not type in the IM window, or if you really feel uncomfortable, feel free to leave the meeting and watch the video at a later time. So that's it for me. So Lucas, whenever you're ready, feel free.
Oh, thanks, Josh. So you guys see there the subject today is I titled it Directory Synchronization Update, and as Josh mentioned, is about highlighting some new features here with the Directory Sync. We have made a number of changes in the last 6 months, and I'll highlight some of them. But in particular, we're going to focus on Password Sync. That's my my information there, so you get my email address. If somehow we don't get your questions answered today, feel free to email me, and I'll do my best to answer your questions, solve your problems. I provide no SLA via email, but again, that's my contact information. Feel free to use it. So here's the agenda for today. So we'll talk a little bit about Password Sync, what it is, how it works, and then I'll go through the typical steps of setting up the Directory Sync tool, the Windows Azure Directory Sync tool, and we'll focus specifically on where Password Sync fits in, where in each step you need to do the configuration to enable Password Sync for your users. And finally, we'll discuss one or two Password Sync scenarios, which are basically things like, can we get Password Sync to work with ADFS single sign-on, and what are the implications there? Update. So again, as I said, this is sort of an update about Directory Sync. So we're not going to cover Directory Sync in sort of full detail, A through Z. We have recently done a number of presentations on both general identity topics as well as DIR sync. And I included here the link from some of the Ignite webcasts and resources that we have out there, and also included a couple links to some tech ed sessions we did just a couple months ago. They're great sessions. They go into great detail about sort of identity topics as well as the their sync application. So those presentations do touch on password sync, but hopefully today we'll cover that in more detail and answer more questions that you may have about password sync. So let's get started here. So what is password sync? So again, it's a feature of the Windows Azure Directory Synchronization Tool, right? It would allow you to synchronize user password hashes from an on-premise AD to the Windows Azure AD. So that, in essence, is going to enable your customers to log on to Windows Azure AD services, such as Office 365, Intune, CRM Online, with the same username and password that users would use on their on-prem Active Directory. because it's part of their sync. There's no additional software to install, so that's the good news there. So by installing the directory sync application, you get an option to enable their sync, and that's it. There's no software that must be installed on domain controllers. There's no reboots required for domain controllers and some of those things that perhaps some of our other tools or third-party tools that do similar functionality requires. So fairly simple, fairly straightforward. You can maybe think of this password sync feature as an easier, less expensive alternative to, you know, the ADFS single sign-on. Of course, keep in mind, you know, it's not the same thing. You're not going to get exactly the same functionality with password sync, and we'll talk a little bit more about that. But as you probably know, with ADFS single sign-on, the user is sort of redirected back to an on-prem ADFS server for authentication. So Windows Azure uses a process of token exchanges between on-premise and the cloud to authenticate that user or get that user authenticated as an on-prem server, and then allow that user to consume, you know, the cloud services, right? So password sync is different in that we are synchronizing that password hash to the cloud, and then the authentication will take place in the cloud. And I put a note in there that, you know, right now, password sync only works on a single forest scenario. So if you're dealing with a multi-forest Active Directory scenario, you are going to have to look at a different solution. So let's talk a little bit about how it works. So from a security perspective, you know, understand that the tool only synchronize password hashes, you know, from on-prem to Azure AD. We never synchronize the password. The clear text password is never visible to the application. It's never copied to the cloud. One of the good things here about a password sync is that the password policy that is in effect is whatever you have on your on-prem Active Directory. We do provide some ability to customize, you know, the password policies in the cloud, but you know, what you can customize there is fairly limited. So basically, this gives you the ability to create your own password policy on-prem, and then leverage that when accessing services on the cloud. And that's, you know, that's something that there's pros and cons. You know, of course, if your on-prem password policy is perhaps less restrictive than the one that we use in the cloud, then you know, accessing the cloud services may not be as secure. But this also is a great feature for a lot of our customers who actually want to implement password policies that are more complex than what we offer with Windows Azure. So that gives you that ability there. And, you know, as far as policy, then, you know, if you can think of the policies, you know, from a complexity perspective, as I talked about, as well as expiration of that policy. So one of the things that we decided from from a design perspective is that when we synchronize that password hash to the cloud, we set that password or that user to have a password that never expires. So the idea there is that you know, password expiration will be controlled by the on-prem policy, will be controlled on-prem. So when a password expires on-prem, user changes the password on-prem, and that gets synchronized to the cloud. So let's see, a question just popped up there about, can I force their sync? So let's try to answer that on this slide right here. So let's talk a little bit about the timing of how password syncs work. We check for password updates in Active Directory around every 2 minutes. Okay, so the usual dir sync of other attributes still run every 3 hours. So as you can see there, we sort of have separate kind of parallel processes working to synchronize all the sort of general Active Directory attributes and to synchronize the password. Keep in mind that even though they're separate processes, today there's no way for you to sort of specify which user's passwords you want to synchronize. Okay, so what the application does is it'll look at whatever scope you have defined for their sync, and if a user falls into that scope, we're going to synchronize the password of that user. So if there's no filtering configured with their sync, we'll look at the entire forest, we'll pick those passwords, and we'll sync to the cloud. If you have somehow implemented some sort of filtering within your Active Directory forest, then the users that match that filtering policy are the users whose passwords will get synchronized. Talking about retries, we do retry failed password syncs. So we that may happen for a number of reasons. Maybe it's just a connectivity issue. Maybe connection to the internet is down at the time when we try to do the password sync. If we're not able to sync, we'll retry that. We retry that every hour for up to a day, and then if we try that many times and we're still not able to synchronize that user's password, we assume there's probably something that needs attention, and we could quit trying to synchronize that. We'll talk a little bit about later on how you can determine if there's a problem, how you can determine what users are problems, and how you can take action. But again, if you run into an issue, you had to address an issue with a user, and it's best that that one day retry period, you can always force a password sync. So that's done via PowerShell. You see the command there, and you might notice from the command that's actually a separate command from how you force a full synchronization or just a synchronization of the regular attributes. So keep that in mind. Separate process there too. When you force a synchronization of their sync, it doesn't necessarily force synchronization of passwords. Okay, and again, the question there, is there password sync specific logging? There's some logging, and we'll talk about that sort of at the end of the presentation here, Mike. So let's jump into deploying their sync. And here you see, sort of the typical steps you would go through to deploy the Windows Azure Directory Synchronization Tool, right? We have some preparation steps. You need to activate their sync within the tenant. And then you need to set up your dir sync server. At that point, you can proceed with synchronizing the directories. Once users are synchronized, you activate users or you license the users to give them access to services. And finally, there's tasks related to just kind of managing dir sync, right? Dir sync is an application that it's not related to like a migration to the cloud. It's a system that you put in place, and it'll stay in place as long as you're using those cloud services. And when we talk about this these steps again, I'm going to cover each one, but really the focus will be on how password sync fits in. So we know that password sync will get enabled sort of in the setup step, on step number 3 there. We'll talk a little bit about initial sync of passwords. We'll talk about what happens with the password if you're doing an activation for a user that has password sync enabled. And then finally, we'll talk about some management tasks, right? So here's where we'll talk about, how to do how to force a full sync. We just touched on that, and also how to monitor event logs that will allow you to see what's happening with that functionality. Okay, so jumping here to the prepare tasks, and as you prepare to deploy, you know, one of the main things to do here is be to decide whether password sync is the right solution for the organization, right? So let's do a quick review here of sort of the identity options that you have to use with sort of cloud services. So option number one, of course, would be to use a cloud identity where you implement, you know, no integration to the on-premises Active Directory. Usually this is used by, you know, a small business that perhaps don't even have, you know, Active Directory in place, and so they're creating their users and groups and whatnot directly in the cloud. Of course, you have the option to implement the directory sync, and now the option to enable password sync with directory sync. So that's of course the focus of the talk here today. And beyond that, we have the option of doing the single sign-on using ADFS. So let's talk a little bit more about differences, you know, between password sync and single sign-on. So now that we have password sync within the directory sync tool, is there ever a reason to use single sign-on? So there's your answer there on some of the differences between using the two. So let's look at using the same username and password. You get that with both, right? So password sync will synchronize the user and the password. Users don't have to remember different username, different password. Of course, with password sync, again, the authentication is happening in the cloud, whereas with single sign-on and ADFS, the user is being redirected to that ADFS server on-prem, and the authentication is taking place on-prem. But we do get to use the same username and password. Password policies, they are controlled on-premises. So, you know, the organization there has full control on password policies. Next, support for two-factor authentication. So that's a checkbox for both systems there. But notice that what's available for 2FA with password sync and ADFS will be different. So what you can do with their sync and password sync today is to leverage the Azure, you know, active authentication. So that's really the only option we have today. As you move to a single sign-on with ADFS, you have just a larger set of 2FA to choose from. Password retries. So what is that? So with single sign-on and ADFS, often when you are within your company network, and you have already signed on to Windows with your corporate credentials, when you launch your Link client or your Outlook client, you may not get prompted to re-enter the password, right? So that's a nice convenient feature there. You're not going to get that with password sync, right? So although we have the same username and password in the cloud, authentication is taking place in the cloud, you're still going to have to re-enter that password. Client access filtering. So what is that? Client access filtering is that ability to maybe filter who has access to certain services based on perhaps where the user is connecting from, based on like an IP address from where the user is connecting. You could do filtering based on the user being a member of a certain group. So there's a number of filtering options that you get with single sign-on and ADFS, right? You can put that logic in your ADFS server, and you're able to allow or deny access to certain services by using those rules. You don't get that with password sync. You know, of course, as far as authentication, you know, some organizations may find that they want the authentication to occur on premises. They may feel perhaps that that's a little bit more secure. So if that's an absolute requirement, that's how single sign-on works. Next item talks about change password available from the web, right? So with a password sync, the password must be changed in the corporation. So you need to change your password. You need to be connected to your corporate network. You need to change that in the on-prem, and the tool will synchronize that to the cloud. With ADFS, you have an option to customize that ADFS login page and add code in there that would allow users to connect from the web, from outside of the corporate network, and still be able to change their password. And finally, another difference that we wanted to highlight there is the ability to support multi-forest configuration. Right now, that's not available for password sync. You can definitely accomplish that if you implement a single sign-on in ADFS. Okay, so talking a little bit more here about some of the preparation steps for implementing their sync. Here's a list of requirements. Very little changes here. I wanted to highlight a couple things. One, the first bullet there, as far as the requirements for the DirSync computer itself. So for those of you who are familiar with DirSync, you might notice that we support DirSync on a Windows Server 2008 SP1. But as far as getting password sync to work properly, we need really need to use the R2 version. So keep that in mind. That documentation, I believe it's already updated out there on the web. So as you look that up, you should see that. But I wanted to make sure you understand that. Data requirements listed here, domain controllers, admin permissions, performance considerations, all those things will not change whether you're implementing password sync or not. And finally, I added a bullet there about the new, object quota, just because that's something new. That's something that we introduced in the last month or so. But you may know that the default object quota for DirSync is 50,000 objects, right? So if you were implementing DirSync, you enable DirSync, you tell DirSync to synchronize your on-prem objects to the cloud. If you have more than 50,000, we would block you and ask you to contact support and explain exactly how many objects you have and sort of ask for a larger quota. So we have added some smarts in the tenant and in the logic there to say that when you actually verify a domain within the tenant, we'll automatically up that code quota to 300,000 users. So as long as you have a verified domain, you can synchronize up to 300,000 objects without having to, contact support and ask for that change. If you don't have a verified domain, then the quota is still your standard 50,000. And then finally here, as far as preparation, I wanted to point out some tools here. If you have done work with DirSync, hopefully you know those tools, but I wanted to point out the on-ramp tool. You can see there, you can access that at onramp.office365.com, and that tool provides a lot of good guidance on basically onboarding to Office 365, and it does have specific questions and suggestions and checks there for DirSync. So definitely leverage that tool. And then we also have another tool called IDFix, which allows you to sort of evaluate your on-prem objects point out objects that will not work synchronizing to the cloud, and this tool can actually go ahead and remediate a lot of those problems for you. So if you haven't worked with that tool, again, I encourage you to check that tool. You have the download link right there. Okay, so that was a little bit about preparation. Next step, let's talk about activating their sync. So before you can synchronize your on-prem objects to the cloud, you need to go into your tenant and you need to enable that. So that's where you see you would log into the tenant with an admin account. You would go under users and groups and find where it says there Active Directory synchronization and click on the setup link. It'll give you a little bit of a explanation of what that means. It'll point you to some helpful documentation, and we'll give you an activate button there to get the process started. We'll give you a are you sure type of question. You'll click activate again, and we'll enable directory sync for that tenant. You notice that right after you request that to be enabled, we let you know that, hey, you know, this is going to take a while. It may take a few hours. It may take up to 24 hours to complete. The way to know when that is done would be to come back to this page. So give it some time. Come back to this page, and you see that that message is gone, and you see that the link that previously said setup now says deactivate. So that's your cue that directory synchronization has been enabled for that tenant. Of course, you can do the same thing via PowerShell. So if you are a scripting kind of person, yeah, you could, instead of going through that wizard, you could issue that command there to accomplish the same thing. And that's how you would activate directory sync. So let's move on and talk about setting up the DirSync server itself. You know, we pointed out the requirements before. One additional thing to point out here, of course, is that, you know, you want to be using a current version. We are up to version like 6.4.6.7 of DirSync. The version that first included the password sync feature was a version that we released right at the end of May, was version 6.3.82. So if you wanted to find out if you have that functionality within an installation, go check the version of your DirSync server. If you are implementing a new server, just make sure they're using the most current. I included there the download link for the current version. And I also wanted to point out there that the Windows Azure team has started a page to show you sort of the version updates, the version history for the DirSync application. So if you wanted to check that, that's a new resource there that can be useful too. You know, as far as the installation, there's really, no difference that concerns password sync. As long as you're installing the current version, you have the ability to turn that on. Something I wanted to point out here that, again, beginning in the late May timeframe, we have upgraded the install to use SQL Express 2012 as opposed to the SQL Express 2008. So that's what you'll see if you implement the current version. Very easy, very straightforward setup. We have a friendly wizard there. You start with the welcome screen. It's going to ask you to accept some terms. Installation folder. You have an option to customize installation folder there. If you have done work with DirSync before, you might notice, you know, the little bit of the rebranding there to Windows Azure Active Directory Sync, as opposed to sort of Microsoft Online Synchronization. You go through the installation, And I guess I'll point out here, the installation of the current version does take a little bit longer than the ones in the past. And I guess, you know, a lot of that has to do with the SQL install. So now that we're using SQL 2012, you notice that the installation package is a little bit larger, and it'll take a little longer to install. But this is what you should see when the installation completes. And we'll give you an option here to kick off the configuration wizard right after you get the install completed. So you may just proceed here, you may uncheck this, and you may run that at a later time. It's your choice. So let's jump to the configuration wizard. So again, you know, getting the DirSync set up is a little bit of a two-step process. One, you install the software. Two, let's get the software configured here. Again, very easy, straightforward 506 windows here, and we'll get that taken care of. We'll start with the welcome screen. The next question here is the wizard asks you to provide some credentials, you know, for Windows Azure. You know, if you're working with Office 365, this is your Office 365 admin account. Okay. Something that that's new here is this used to require a non-federated account to work. If you have implemented Active Directory Federation and you want to use a federated account, that's an admin account that will work for you right now with the current version. Next, we're going to ask for some credentials to your on-prem Active Directory. And those credentials, they do need to be an enterprise administrator. And I wanted to point out here that, you know, this credentials, the all-powerful enterprise admin credentials, are only used here to set up this configuration. It's not used by DirSync and on an ongoing basis. We'll use that enterprise credentials to be able to discover the forest, right? So DirSync by default is going to try to look at the entire forest, not just the domain. So that's why we do need enterprise credentials. It'll do other things, like it'll actually create the service account that'll be used by DirSync on an ongoing basis. So if you are concerned about providing such account here, you can always create an account, give it enterprise admin credentials, run through this configuration wizard, and then you can delete that account. Because again, the enterprise admin's account is not used by DirSync as an ongoing basis. The next window is about your hybrid deployment. If you don't have Exchange in your Active Directory, you'll get a sort of a grayed out window such as this one. And then finally, this is the new window that allows you to enable password sync. Gives you some information there, link for more information, and very easy checkbox. So that's really all you need to do. You need to make sure to check that box to enable password sync. And by the way, if you ever decided that you wanted to disable password sync, you would rerun this configuration wizard and just uncheck that box. It'll run through the configuration. And then finally, it'll give you an option right there to kick off, you know, the first synchronization between your on-prem Active Directory and Windows Azure AD. So you can leave that checked and just click Finish. If you choose to uncheck that at this point, you know, whenever the first schedule comes up, we'll run that synchronization. Okay, so that was about setting up and configuring the tool. Let's jump right in into synchronizing the directories. So after the wizard runs, DirSync will do initial synchronization, which will be a full synchronization of all the attributes, all the users within the scope, and all of their attributes, and it'll do the same for the passwords, right? So it'll run a full password sync and synchronize passwords for all those users in scope. So again, we do have an option for you to filter certain users out of their sync, certain OUs or domains. And if you do that, users that are filtered out of their sync scope will not have their passwords synchronized. And also wanted to note here that passwords for federated users are not synchronized. So if users are within scope, but they are configured as federated users, we are not going to synchronize those passwords. And we'll talk a little bit more about that that scenario in a later slide here. Let's jump to activating users. So, you know, DirSync will create those objects, will get a list of objects of users from your on-prem Active Directory, will create those users in Windows Azure, like in Office 365, but won't necessarily license them or give them access right of the services. So what you need to do next is activate those users. And I wanted to point out here that as far as password sync, you know, let's say you select your user, you say I want to activate this user, you assign the proper license, and you click next. Typically, if password's not in place, at that point, we would assign a temporary password to the user, and display what that password is, give you an option to email that password, that temporary password, to the user or to an admin. In case of password sync being enabled, you're going to see something like this. We're going to assign the license to the user. We're going to activate that user, but we won't do anything with the password. The system is going to detect that this user is configured for password sync. So then finally, let's talk a little bit about managing their sync. So once the tool is in place, users are being synchronized, passwords are synchronized. A couple of things that you might want to know, as I mentioned, if for some reason you need to disable password sync, you just need to rerun the configuration wizard and uncheck that enable box. So fairly straightforward there. Wanted to point out also that the page that we're publishing now with the version updates may be a good way for you to stay informed of new versions of DirSync. We'll deploy new functionality here and there, and hey, we may even find some fixes here and there, and we'll deploy new versions to address those fixes. So something you might want to do is go check out that page, subscribe to that page, and get notifications when that page is updated, and if you see something there that may apply to your organization, make sure that you upgrade your DirSync installation. And we have some good news also on the upgrade. If you have worked with DirSync for a while, you know that some of the previous versions of DirSync, whenever you tried to upgrade, we did require you to sort of manually remove that application and then install the new version. So we have improved on that. And if you need to do an upgrade, we'll be able to do an in-place upgrade without requiring the removal first. And then finally, part of managing the application and specifically understanding, password sync would be to monitor, the application event logs. Somebody asked earlier about, is there a log for that? And really the place that you want to look at is the app log. I have a link there of an article that explains that in detail, and I'll show you here, just a few of the things that you can look for. So you'll see in the application log, the event source is always going to be directory synchronization. One of the events that you might see is event 650. And we record that in the log every time we look in Active Directory for password changes. and then we make that call to discover password changes, and then we record back whether that was successful or not. So if for some reason we were not successful retrieving that list of updated passwords from the on-prem AD, you're going to see an event, 652 in there. So that'll tell you there is an error, and then we'll try again later, and hopefully it'll work the next time. The next step in the process would be to then, once we have that list of passwords that changed, to synchronize those to Windows Azure, synchronize those to the cloud. So, I'm sorry, I'm jumping ahead here. I wanted to point out here another process that the DirSync process does, which is to do a ping, right? So we are checking for password changes every 2 minutes. It may be that we go through a period of like 30 minutes and we don't have any changes. So even if we don't have any changes, we want to sort of just ping Windows Azure and let the system know that everything is working, we're talking, but hey, we don't have any password changes to sync. And that's what these events here are about. So if a 30-minute window went by and there were no changes, we'll just kind of tell Windows Azure. If we're able to successfully talk to Windows Azure, we'll log that as a good thing. If we're not able to, we'll log that as event 655, which will tell you there is some sort of failure talking to the cloud, typically maybe a network connectivity issue. And then finally here, I wanted to point out the events that we use to record the changes that we synchronize. So event 656 will basically collect a list of the users whose passwords have changed and that we're going to try to synchronize to the cloud. We're including that list from 1 to 50 users. If somehow within that window more than 50 users change their passwords, we'll just have multiple messages with that list of users. And here the results are a little bit different. So we'll record the results of both bad good syncs and bad syncs in event 657. So after event 656, you should see 657. It'll have that user, and it'll let you know whether the password sync for that particular user was successful or failed. Beyond this event ideas that I just highlighted here, if we run into an error that's sort of, outside this sort of typical process, usually we log those errors as event 611. So you can keep that in mind too. If you're setting up monitoring, you want to probably also monitor 611 as an error related to password sync that you probably want to look at, maybe take some action. Okay, so that's all I had as far as manage. Let's jump here to password sync scenarios. I have a couple scenarios that I wanted to cover with you, and they're related to password sync and single sign-on. So can they work together, right? So that's a common question that we get, and they can. The important aspect to understand here is that those things are based on a given domain or namespace. Right, so a given domain can be configured for a single sign-on or not. If that domain is configured for single sign-on, the user using that domain as their identity domain will be configured for single sign-on, for federation. And then users that are using a different domain, a different namespace, would then get their, passwords synchronized to the cloud. So from that, you can see that basically, users within, a single namespace are not able to be configured as both, password sync or SSO. Depending on their domain and how their domain is configured within the tenant, they will either have their password synchronized to the cloud, or they will authenticate via single sign-on. another questions that we get, and actually we have had a number of customers decide to do this. You know, once we released the password sync feature, we have had customers that looked at that and said, hey, this is really what we want, what we need, and let's go ahead and change our single sign-on ADFS implementation to just using the third sync password sync feature. And so we have this documented out there on TechNet on how to do that. There's a lot of details there, but basically you have two ways that you can do that. You could convert just a few users from federated to password sync. And basically the way you would do that is by changing the identity domain for that user, right? You would reconfigure that user from having a domain that's configured for federation to a domain that's not, a domain that's just sort of managed within the system. Or you do have an option, of course, to convert all users by converting the entire domain. So if you have a domain that you have configured for federation, we have documented the steps that you have to go through to change that domain configuration from federated to managed. And once you do that, all the users that use that domain for their identity will be able to use password sync instead of single sign-on. And then finally, another question that we get sometimes is, has to do with, overriding a synchronized password. So we talked about how passwords get synchronized. What happens if you, let's say, try to use PowerShell to reset a user's password? And that will actually work. So if an administrator uses PowerShell to change somebody's password, they'll be able to override that password that was synchronized. As soon as you do that, of course, the cloud password policies will apply to that user, right? So that new password will have to comply with the cloud password policies. And in that scenario, next time the user changes their password on-prem, the password sync process will kick in and then will overwrite that password in the cloud that had been set up by the administrator. And that was the last scenario that I had there. And so just in closing here, I provided a bunch of links here for you, resources. There's the implementing password synchronization, the first link there, and the password synchronization troubleshooting guide has a lot of what we talked about today. So if you need to review that, please check those links. And then I also included some other links there that are more sort of general DIRS sync type information, but many of those links will have some reference to password sync. So hopefully this will be helpful to you. This is what I had to present to you guys today.
Great. Thank you, Lucas, so much for the presentation. We do have about 10 minutes for some Q&A. I know there's a ton of discussion on the IM chat window, but if you did not get your question answered, please feel free to type those in again. And also, thanks for everyone that was helping answer questions. And also, if we don't get to your question today, please feel free to message me on the community, and I'll make sure Lucas gets a look at it. I also wanted to quickly say, while people are typing the questions, that you can see our next Ignite webcast at this forum link. We have one next week on Exchange Online special topics. But for now, let's spend the next 10 minutes answering any additional questions you might have. And I'm also going to post just a couple survey questions in the background here. So I guess here's our first one from Kurt. And then Lucas, can you see the IM chat window?
Yes, I'm there.
Okay, great. Thanks.
So, Kurt, as far as hybrid environment, I mean, there's no issue there. When you implement hybrid for Exchange, you you should be able to choose between a cloud identity. You know, of course, it requires their sync, but you can choose between a cloud identity. You can choose to do password sync, and you can also choose to do ADFS with that hybrid implementation. Let's see, this window scrolls fast. Let me see. Will the deck be available to us? I think Josh answered that. So the link, if you look through the window there, there's a link where the deck will be posted. So look for that in the next few days, and it should be there. That same link will tell you what the schedule is for the upcoming, you know, webcasts. Josh, I don't know if the chat window is captured in the recording. Is that the case?
It will be captured. You could see the questions in the video recording. Yes.
So I have a question here. How do we implement their sync and password sync after the fact? So if you have already implemented their sync, you have a tenant. You have been running for a while with separate credentials. And so the answer there, Errol, is basically you need to upgrade your their sync installation. I'm assuming that the version of their sync that you're running does not support password sync. So you just need to go back to that their sync server, make sure that it meets the requirements of the current their sync. Like we said, you know, Windows 2008 R2 SP1. If that OS supports it and you meet the other requirements, you just need to upgrade their syncing there. If you have a fairly old version of their sync, you're going to have to manually remove it and then install the new version. We do have some documentation out there. If you follow some of the links that I had at the end of the presentation, we do talk about you know, how to upgrade directory sync. We talk about how do you upgrade if you're using the same server, how do you upgrade if you're using a different server. So we do have that documentation out there. But bottom line is you need to implement the current version of their sync. And when you go through the configuration wizard, you need to make sure to select that box to enable password sync. Of course, you're going to have to coordinate that with your users, right? Because, you know, the password that they're using to log on to Office 365 is going to change. So you want to make sure to schedule that with users, make sure they understand what's happening, so they're able to get to their services.
Okay, I think we have time for just two or three more questions.
Okay, so there was a question there from David regarding time to sync, and you know, time varies. We published some you know, sort of general guidelines that you should expect general dir sync, not necessarily password sync, but general dir sync to take about an hour for every 5,000 users. So if you're doing initial sync, you have 10,000 users, you know, you should expect that to take a few hours. So I would allow, you know, 1 to 3 hours to get that completed. You know, of course, that's for a full sync. After the full sync, we do incremental syncs, and those are very, very fast. So, you know, it's not uncommon to see an incremental sync take place, you know, in a minute. There's a question there. The last question I see there is about, can you have a mix of accounts where some have sync passwords, but others still use Office 365 only passwords? So I guess the answer there is yes. You need to plan that, carefully to accomplish what you're looking for. But like we said, it's based on the general scope for their sync, right? So typically, all users that are being their synced will have their passwords synced. So if for some reason you want to have a subset of users that don't have their passwords synced, right now, your two options for that would be you would have to exclude them from their sync, right? So you would have to, exclude that OU perhaps, or from the their sync, or you would have to, and in that case, you would have to create the user directly in the cloud. So I guess now you can have that, but you wouldn't be able to, for example, have a user that is their synced with password enabled for that installation of their sync and have that user's password not sync. That's sort of a question and a request that we have gotten, and we're looking at possibly providing that in the future. But those are the ways to get around that today.
Okay, great. Maybe is there one more question?
Yes, I see another question there right above that, which seems to deal with federated domains, right? So the way that it works there, and I'm not sure that I understand your question exactly, but if you have let's say you have two domains in your tenant. You have one domain configured for federation and one domain that's not configured for federation, right? You can install the current version of their sync and enable password sync. Once you do that and we start syncing passwords, we're going to sync passwords for those users whose identity domain is the non-federated domain. We're going to skip syncing, the password for users that are configured with a federated domain. So hopefully that helps you out there.
Okay, great. I think we have time for one more. If you see one more, if not, we can. Do you see one more question that you could answer?
Looking here. The question there about soft match. Soft match doesn't change the fact here. I mean, their sync is going to run if you created an object in the cloud, and then their sync runs, and it's able to, based on the primary SMTP address of that cloud object, be able to match that object to an on-prem object. It'll link those two objects, right, based on the soft match logic. If those objects are linked and you have password sync enabled, then we're going to synchronize the password for that user. So, something to look for there is if soft match does kick in after you enable password sync, then the password for that cloud user is going to change, and you might want to have a way to notify him.
Okay, great. Well, thank you, Lucas, so much for the presentation. Great job. And thank you, everyone, for joining our Ignite webcast. You can find the PowerPoint and the video recording later today or in a few days on the blog post, the original blog post. And be sure to look for our upcoming Ignite webcast sessions, which you can find at these links here. But thanks again for joining. And with that, I think I'm going to end the call. And we look forward to seeing you on an upcoming Ignite webcast. But thanks again, everyone, and thanks, Lucas.